In this screencast, we will take a look at inverse responses. Inverse responses can come from systems which are second or higher order systems, which have a lead lag element to them and are overdamped. So here in our analysis, we'll focus solely on second order overdamped systems. It's second order because we have S squared in the denominator. Since it's overdamped, what that means is the fact that tau 1 and tau 2 are both positive numbers. We also have a time constant in the numerator, which is equal to tau A. So if we were to look at a response with step function, recall the fact that the step is going to be equal to M, the magnitude of the step function, over S, the step in the Laplace domain. And if we were to separate and do some math, we'd end up with what our response would look like. This here shows what the response is both in the Laplace domain and in the time domain. Now we will make a few sketches of this response. So the first one will be the case where tau A is greater than tau 1. And here we're going to assume the fact that tau 1 is in all cases greater than tau 2. So here our x-axis will be time. And y is the magnitude of our output variable. So what happens when tau A is greater than tau 1 is we get something that looks along these lines, where they will all converge to km, but they will all exhibit some degree of overshoot. They will go higher than the new steady state answer, which will be km, and then they will settle down towards the new steady state. They're technically not oscillating functions because of how they overshoot and then just immediately reach the steady state. They do never go below the steady state value once it overshoots, making this a non-oscillatory system. The second case is when tau A is in between 0 and tau 1. Again, we're assuming that tau 1 is greater than tau 2. And what we get here is something that looks like your general overdamped responses. Stable and monotonic and reaching the steady state value. The third one is for a case when tau A is less than 0. So when tau A is less than 0, we get something where dips below the 0 point, so it goes into negative territory, and then works itself back up to the steady state. In the case like this, where it starts in the direction of the opposite sign, where it starts with a negative number and ends at a positive number, or vice versa, starts at a positive number and then ends at a negative number, this is known as an inverse response. So now the question becomes is how can you get an inverse response? Or in other words, how can a tau A value be negative? In order to show this, let's first start with the question of is how to get a system which is a second order lead lag. And there are really two major ways by which this can happen. The first is via an interacting process in series. And the second one, which is more lends itself more commonly to inverse processes, is cases where you have two first order processes in parallel. So how do we get a lead lag system out of that? Or more importantly, how do we get a system which could potentially have a negative tau A? To look at that, let's look at a hypothetical process where we have K1 over tau 1s plus 1. And K2 over tau 2s plus 1. We'll write the signs as pluses and negative. And what we end up with when we reach our summing point here is K1 over tau 1s plus 1 minus K2 over tau 2s plus 1. So if we find a least common denominator, we end up with, if we simplify this further, we end up with, so if we were to get this into standard form, let's first group the S terms together. That would be K1 tau 2 minus K2 tau 1 S plus K1 minus K2 divided by tau 1S plus 1 times tau 2S plus 1. To get into our standard form, we'll factor out the K1 minus K2. So this will become K1 minus K2. This would represent the gain multiplied by K1 tau 2 minus K2 tau 1 over K1 minus K2 S plus 1 divided by tau 1 S plus 1 times tau 2 S plus 1. So if this term here is less than 0, that means that we have an inverse response. So to get an inverse response, recall what the graph looks like. It starts going in one direction and then ends in the other direction. So in the case that we drew in our graph here, it started in the negative domain and then ended in the positive domain. So what that means is the fact that we have to have two parallel processes competing against each other. So what that means is the fact that in order for it to be inverse, each process has to have its moment in the sun. In other words, one process wins at short times, and another process wins at long times. What does it mean to win? Well, in other words, the value, the magnitude of that function has to be higher. So if we think about this for a second, for a process to win at long times, that means the fact that S approaches zero. So in other words, the denominator becomes unimportant. So if we look back at our function, we have our competing transfer functions here. At long times, the denominators become useless. So in other words, that means the fact that you have to have, that all that's left in this analysis is the difference of the gains, K1 and K2. So for your process to win at long times, you have to have a larger gain. But at shorter times, you're going to have an influence of the time constant. Therefore, at short times, it's dictated by the process which responds quicker. So it's the shorter tau generally, because in theory, you're also thinking about a comparison between the one process and the other with respect to the gain. And we can see this by looking at the definition of the inverse, which takes into account the difference in the gains as seen in the denominator, but also takes into account the magnitude of the time constants, noting the fact that in this multiplication, the process gain of one function goes with the time constant of the other. And this makes sense because if one process wins at short times and long times, that means that it won't be inverse. It'll be one of the two other graphs we showed here, either the overdamped function or the one that shows overshoot. So in order for there to be inverse, each process has to win. So to show this, let's do an example where K1 is 3, tau1 is 2, and tau2 is 5. For what range of K2 will we have inverse? So if we look at this, we see the fact that K1 is 3, and tau1 is 2, and tau2 is 5. With tau1 being less than tau2, that shows the fact that tau1 responds quicker. So therefore, tau1 is going to win at short times to some degree. So that gives us an insight on the magnitude of what K2 needs to be. So to do this, we can do some mathematical analysis. So this will be, if we use what we've developed here, we'll have K1, which is 3, multiplied by tau2, which is 5, minus K2, which we're trying to find, and tau1, which is 2. We can divide that by K1 minus K2. In order for this to be an inverse, it has to be less than 0. So what we can do here is take a look at our numerator and our denominator. So in order for this to be less than 0, that means the fact that the numerator and denominator have to have opposing signs. So if we look at this, our numerator is 15 minus 2k2. Our numerator will be positive when k2 is less than 7.5. And it will be negative when k2 is greater than 7.5. For our denominator, it will be positive when k2 is less than 3, but will be negative when k2 is greater than 3. Now, let's look at the possible pairs. So our two possible pairs here are the fact that the numerator is positive and that the denominator is negative. For that to happen, we'd have to have k2 be less than 7.5, and k2 be greater than 3. This can happen from 3 to 7.5. But if we look at the case where the numerator is negative and the denominator is positive, that is trying to see the commonality between k2 being greater than 7.5 and k2 being less than 3. This cannot happen. So therefore, the system will be inverse when k2 is between 3 and 7.5. Practically, this can happen, and there are a few cases where inverse processes can happen. For example, a mercury thermometer, where our competing processes here is the fact that you have glass expanding, so therefore a larger volume, which would cause the mercury level to decrease, and the mercury expanding.